Hello, I'm Blake Ress, Commissioner of the Indiana High School Athletic Association. Today, I'd like to tell you about a friend to the more than 160,000 student athletes in the state of Indiana, Farm Bureau Insurance. In their own low-key way, Farm Bureau Insurance has played a key role in the success of high school athletic programs throughout the state. Since joining the IHSAA as its exclusive corporate partner in 1988, Farm Bureau Insurance has contributed more than $3 million in support of high school student athletes. On behalf of all the member schools of the IHSAA, we would like to take this opportunity to thank Farm Bureau Insurance for its support of our young people.
Welcome you to Indianapolis and Conseco Fieldhouse in the heart of downtown and the Class A Championship game on the Indiana Cable Network between University and Fort Wayne Canterbury. Hello fans, Jerry Baker and Jane Schott, happy to have you along. Jane, this is the Class A classification. These are the little schools that could, man. This has got to be a big moment in their lives.
Well, particularly for a team like University that has just come into their existence and they're already in the state championship in their infancy of the IHSAA.
Let's take a look at the tournament trail, show you how these teams got here. First off, for University, a winner in the University sectional, won the Southwestern Shelbyville Regional. They had to beat the 10th-ranked team in the state, White River Valley, did that by 57-38. Then at the Jeffersonville semi-state, knocked off the number 4 team, Northeast Dubois. They won their games by an average of 29 per game. Jane, their key player among many is number 3, Kate Adler.
Well, she averages 16.5 points a game and 6 rebounds to go along with 3 assists. So she's the complete player. Look for her to have a big game. If she can get to the free throw line, their team will have an easier time scoring.
Now let's take the tournament trail for Fort Wayne Canterbury. They knocked off a couple of teams at the Elkhart Christian Academy sectional, then had to beat the number 1 team in the state, Oregon Davis, in the Caston Regional, and follow that up by beating number 2 Couch that night. And then at the Plymouth semi-state, a win over Southern Wells, number 12. Their winning margin, about 18.5 points per game. And Tabitha Gerardot, a 5'11 sophomore, she is their key player.
Well, she is only a sophomore, but she's their main gun. She averages a double-double, which for any league is outstanding, and she will be a key for them inside and outside today. They'll get the ball into her hands early and often.
It's the first of 4 championship games. We're glad you could join us. The opening tip-off for Class A coming up next on the Indiana Cable Network. Conseco Fieldhouse getting set for the Class A championship game. And as we approach the opening tip-off, let's get the keys to the game. Jane, what do you got here first off for University?
Well, University Trailblazers need to control the tempo. They want to press and run and keep it a full-court game while they attack the basket and try to get Canterbury into foul trouble. They've got to contain Tabitha Gerardot to have success here this morning. And as far as Canterbury goes, Coach Kreiger says often, just do what we do. They've been very successful at that. If they can establish a post presence with Gerardot, and if they can have great senior leadership, then they're going to be in great shape this morning.
All right, Jane, thank you very much. The opening tip-off is coming up. The Class A title is on the line here on the Indiana Cable Network. Well, the crowd's still coming in here at Conseco Fieldhouse. One section on the far side filled up with University Trailblazer fans, and behind us, of course, the Fort Wayne Canterbury Cavaliers. Here's the starting lineup for University. They are led by Katie Adlam and Bria Sneed. They account for 33 points per game. Their top rebounder is number 13, Brittany Williams, and then you see Ieysha Walker and Amy Strawbridge. The University head coach, a gentleman who is new to this championship world, Bill Thornburg, fifth year at the school, 78-36 is a winning record. For the Canterbury Cavaliers, here's their starting lineup. Their leading scorer and rebounder is Tabitha Gerardot, down at the bottom of your screen, number 33, 18.2 points and 10.8 rebounds, so she averages a double-double. Quite a player is Tabitha Gerardot, a 5'11 sophomore. And the head coach at Canterbury, Scott Kreiger, in his 10th year at the school, 155-77, winning percentage of 78%. Go. Here's the team comparison. Jane, anything jump out at you as you take a look at those numbers?
Well, both of these teams like to press and run, so this is going to be a very fast-paced game. You look at their offensive averages, over 55 points a game, both of them, so we're going to see some great offense here today as well as good defense.
The University will be in the dark uniforms. There's the visiting club on the scoreboard. The officials for the game here this morning are Rob McGriff, Mark Hopper, and Pat Strong. They've earned the right to come to do this championship game. Backdoor cut, knocked away by University. It's the first turnover of the game. University on the hustle up court. They're 20 wins and 6 losses, averaging 57.2 points a game, giving up just under 41 per. They like to keep the score low because that's where they, Jane, I think they feel they have an advantage.
Well, I think because they like to press and get really in the defensive pressure going early on, that's how they're going to keep the score low against any team they face.
Very consistently strong in the fundamentals, as you might expect, but they throw it away. That's the first turnover now against University in the game, and then given right back. The driving layup is off the mark that time by Adlib, but put back up and good.
Both teams look very nervous. The ball seems to be bouncing around for both teams on offense. A lot of times defense will prevail in that first quarter until teams settle down.
Well, let's face it, Jane, they've not played in Conseco Fieldhouse ever before. They are the small schools, used to smaller crowds, if you will. If they're not nervous, there's something wrong with it.
Right, absolutely. And both teams' first time here at the state finals.
And a held ball, the possession arrow given to University. Fort Wayne Canterbury averaging 57.5 points and giving up 44.4. So as Jane pointed out, when you take a look at those numbers, both on University and Fort Wayne Canterbury, offensively and defensively, well, there's just not much difference in either of those two teams.
We knew it was going to be a great matchup because they are very similar, not only in their numbers, but in their styles.
The one thing that does jump out at you, neither one of these clubs is a good three-point shooting team. They're shooting 23%. A bank shot goes in by Ieysha Walker. And it's 4-0 now with about a minute and a half gone so far in this game. Again, in the white uniforms, Fort Wayne Canterbury at 20-5, in the dark uniforms, University. It's an interesting story, University, as they almost throw it away, and in fact, they do, and that'll be their third turnover of the game already.
University has two main scorers in Snead and Adlam, and they will put up the bulk of the shots. You see Adlam going to the basket.
Driving right down the lane, shot rattles out of there for Adlam. The rebound comes off to Canterbury. They average over 30 rebounds a game, 31.1. That's pretty strong. And there's another rebound. University averaging almost 39 per game, so both clubs go to the boards very well. Long range shot, short, just grazed the rim that time by Walker, and the rebound comes off to Canterbury.
Walker only an 18% shooter. Jerry, that one looked dead on.
It was
just a tad short. And she, and maybe the double lines might cause the girls to not know where to shoot the three-pointer. She was about 3 feet behind the line.
Now, there's two lines out there. One a little further back, of course, out of bounds, belongs to Canterbury. They'll be using the blue line. Canterbury and University have played twice since the year 2000, both times in Carmel. That's actually where University is located, and Canterbury won both of those meetings. Baseline shot no good. The rebound taken down and stolen away this time by University. The most recent meeting was the 26th of January in 2007, and Canterbury won 62-50 in that game, so they've got a 2-0 lead in the series, if you will. 4:50 to go, 4-0 basketball game. Canterbury's had a couple of decent looks at it, but that defense is really stifling on the part of University, and they force another turnover.
Well, University in a man-to-man, and every time a Canterbury player catches the basketball, there's a defender right on her and making it very difficult to relieve that pressure. Canterbury's got to go to the basket and take some of that pressure off the ball handlers.
University, or Canterbury, is 9-0 in games against Class A opponents this year. Rebound taken off inside. Good rebound by Gerardot. We talked about how impressive she was. They are 48-5 against Class A teams over the past 5 years, so they've been dominant in that bracket.
Yeah, they have. They really play a lot of bigger schools as well. So their kids, when they play a smaller school, that's the almost easy part of their schedule. So you can see why they get to the state championship.
Almost halfway through the first quarter, and Canterbury is still looking for their first points. Will they get him here? No, they will not. Put back up, and they still won't get it. And the rebound is finally thrown back inbounds and off the legs of number 21 for Canterbury. That's Becky Pedro and out of bounds and already a timeout. Timeout has been taken with 3 minutes and 57 seconds to play here in this opening quarter of play for the Class A title. And it's a shutout so far with University on top of Canterbury, 4-0. Third annual IHSAA Girls State Championships on the Indiana Cable Network are brought to you by Taco Bell, the proud statewide sponsor of the IHSAA Championship Telecast and the IHSAA Centennial Scholarship Awards. By TripToCollege.org, be your child's MVP and start planning for their college today. And by Comcast, TV, Internet, Voice, Comcast, it's all about options. Jerry Baker and Jade Schott courtside at Conseco Fieldhouse in downtown Indy. And so far, University pitching a shutout as we have just passed the halfway mark of the first quarter.
Well, Canterbury can't find the range, 0 for 5 from the field so far, but University just keeps piling them on.
Ieysha Walker, second field goal. She has 4 of the 6. Katie Adlam has the other 2, and it's a 6-0 lead right now in favor of University. And they may get their first 2 points and finally do. That's Tabitha Gerardot. Gerardot coming in with an 18.2 scoring average, 10.8 rebounds. She shoots 53% from the floor, and the long-range 3 is good.
Rhea Sneed steps up and knocks one down for University. You mentioned, Jerry, neither team a terrific outside shooting team. She's 31%, one of the better ones on her team.
They only shoot as a team some 23%. Backdoor cut again, lost out of bounds. Turnover will give the ball back to University. And unofficially, that's the 6th turnover now on Canterbury. They still got the jitters, Jane.
Well, I think they're really looking hard to get the ball into Tabitha Gerardo's hands because they've got to settle down offensively. You're not seeing them run any of their sets. They're just trying to force it inside.
And a turnover this time by University as they tried to work the ball into the middle. No advantage on the break. University gets back in a hurry, but nonetheless, they get the pull-up shot from Aubrey Holle.
Well, she's the senior leadership that I think needed to come out early on. She's had 19 points in her freshman season against University. She's a player that has played very well through their tournament trail, so she's got to be big here for Canterbury this morning.
9-4 is your score with the Blazers out in front of the Cavaliers.
You see Holle going all the way to the basket, and that's what she does well. A little jump stop and a nice touch over the top of the rim. Maybe that'll settle her down. She's the only senior that starts for them. The rest are freshmen and sophomores, so it's no wonder they're a little nervous.
You know, I was watching during the national anthem, Aubrey Holle, who has the basketball, I believe it was her, they could hardly contain themselves on the sideline as they were standing at attention, very respectful, but you could just see the nervous energy of them.
Yeah, Coach Kreiger mentioned before the game that they didn't feel like they had much practice this week. They ate a lot, and they had a lot of excitement, but he wasn't sure how much practice, so maybe they'll settle down here in the
season. Here's the traveling violin. It's interesting, when I talked to University head coach Bill Thornburg, who's in his 5th year at the school, he's been, of course, the only coach they've got, with the school being so new, he said he told them at the very first practice session, I want to be playing on March 1st, and guess what today is?
March 1st. He also mentioned he didn't think his players really believed that until into the season they started to believe that that was a possibility.
It's an interesting story, a personal story, if you will. The shot is off the mark. University has it now with less than 2 minutes to go. There's a golf course that I belong to up on the northwest side of Indianapolis, way up north. And when I come home, I drive by University High School. And I had never thought there's a traveling violation called against Canterbury. Never thought much about it. It's a school that's obviously in the building stages. And lo and behold, here they are in the state finals. And their boys team is doing quite well this year.
Well, it's kind of fun to watch programs rise like that. Obviously, that's what when I mentioned they were in their infancy, 5 years compared to a lot of other schools and how long they've been around the IHSAA, that's not very much.
Rebound comes off to Canterbury. University, their boys team is ranked number 10 in the final AP poll. They went 17-4 during the regular season. And a foul will be called, one of the few that we've, in fact, the first that we've seen so far in this game today. Take a look at the foul again, Jane.
Well, what I mentioned earlier, a lot of pressure. So Canterbury now taking the ball to the basket, as you see Aubrey Holle getting inside to help defense, slid down and reached. Anytime you make that reach, she raked her across the arm pretty good too, so she's gonna get 2 free throws.
The first approach is good. Holle from the free throw line is a very good shooter, hitting 80%. For every free throw made tonight, this morning, by the way, Taco Bell is donating $10 up to $500 to the IHSAA Centennial Scholarship Award. So there's a couple of successful free throws and the fourth point for Holle. And a minute 19 to go in the opening quarter, and 9-6 your score in favor of the team in the dark uniforms, the deep dark blue of University. Going to get her own rebound that time was Walker, and then it's a held ball with the possession arrow going to Canterbury.
Walker's been very active offensively. She only averages 3.6 points a game, but already has here four this morning, and she's being a very aggressive on the offensive end.
Canterbury stopped a 43-game win streak for Oregon Davis, and then came back with a win over number two Couts. Aubrey Holle went down with a gash on her head. There's another turnover in the driving layup. Nice defensive play turned in at the other end by Cassie Krieger.
Well, Katie Adlin stepped in the passing lane. A little bit of a lazy pass. Krieger, great job on the hustle play. Catches up. You don't want to give up and just assume she's going to make the layup. She actually got the block without the foul.
I mentioned Aubrey Holle went down with a gash on her head in that Couch game. She was taken to the hospital, had stitches, but it's not slowed her down at all here so far this morning. Rebound comes off to Canterbury. Less than a minute to go.
Gerardo pulling down the boards already. She has three total rebounds, and we're not even to the first quarter break. There's another.
Yep.
And another, almost.
And a hell ball. Possession row will send it back the other way to University. University, we've talked about the school being young. Jane, they opened in 2000, the school did. Their first basketball program was in 2003-2004, so their third year of state tournament eligibility. And you look at the coaching staff on the far sideline of University.
Well, and their coach, Bill Thornburg, a runner, actually. And I asked him, how'd you get into coaching basketball? And he said, you know, he'd done some overseas travel and did a little bit of playing, things like that. And, you know, he just kind of was interested in it. And then they needed a basketball coach, so there he was. And he's done a terrific job with this program.
Graduate of Brownsburg High School and Butler University. Brownsburg's high school team having a great year this year. This shot, the rebound comes off to Katie Adlin, who averages 6 rebounds a game. 14 seconds to go in the opening quarter. Long range shot off the mark, taken down by Canterbury. 9-6 is the score. Not much scoring in the opening quarters. Both clubs trying to find their feet, so to speak. And a foul will be called out around the free throw line.
Once again, Canterbury pushing in transition. A nice rebound by Cassie Krieger. She's played really well the last couple of tournament games. She finds her senior running mate there, Aubrey Holle, who again attacks the basket. Pressure defense, you got to get them off.
That was on Jordan Foyer, who came in during the last timeout break. Under the hoop, ball knocked away, and that'll be the end of the first quarter. Not a particularly well-played first quarter, but as Jane pointed out, both clubs trying to find themselves and steady themselves. After one, it's 9-6 in favor of University for the Class A championship. Through this Class A championship, 9-6 lead for University over Fort Wayne Canterbury. Into the University huddle. Here comes the school bio, the Trailblazers, blue, white, and gold. Principal's Chuck Webster. Stan Colasano is the athletic director. They are not in a conference. And there's the enrollment of 175 in Class A school. First state final appearance in any sport, but you get the feeling, Jane, that it may be the first of several to come, the way they've established this program so early.
Yeah, you would expect, because, again, both of these teams have very young teams. And so not only are they, you know, probably nervous to beat the state for their first state championship, they've got opportunity to come back.
And a foul will be called, and once again, they're going to get Jordan Foyer. Interesting note on Jordan Foyer. She is the younger sister of Brooke Foyer, whom we'll see later on tonight, who plays for Carmel. Here are the first quarter stats, Dave.
That's a great accomplishment. The first quarter stats, you look, you know, Canterbury just really struggling from the field. 2 for 12. Now, they are hitting the offensive rebound, so you can see them out-rebounding University 10-7. But the 8 turnovers have given them less opportunity to get shots in the basket, and that's why right now University is ahead.
First free throw by Krieger is no good. She's a 5'7 sophomore. And yes, she is the daughter of the head coach, Scott. One out of two, her first point of the ball game. Cassie coming in with a 10.5 per game average. And that just kind of indicates the jitters. Let's hope they get settled down, because you'd like to see a good game from both teams, regardless of who wins.
Well, I mentioned the last two tournament games, the semi-state and the games for them, kind of the X factor, stepped up. She still is only a sophomore, so very young player to be in this kind of atmosphere.
Adlin with the basketball out high, bounce pass to the near side. They're looking to go inside if they can to Walker, but they just can't get it in there. Now the bounce pass goes in and it's knocked away. And a held ball in the possession arrow will stay with University.
Good defense that time by Canterbury. You see the pass. It's a nice bounce pass. I like that, but it's a little slow. And the post player did not hold the post, didn't hold the seal long enough, and allowed Gerardot to get around.
Neither club shooting well. University's missed its last seven shots. Canterbury has missed its last five field goal attempts. 9-7 basketball game, very low scoring. We anticipated the low scoring, but maybe not 9-7. Boyer way out high, gets a little bit of room to dribble on the far side, then shifts it back out into the lane, an off-balance shot, no good, but right back up, it's no good again, this time by Brittany Williams, and she'll draw a foul.
Right now, Canterbury doing a pretty good job of limiting the touches of Katie Adlam and Bria Sneed for University. So some other players are having to step up for the Trailblazers. As you see, going to the free throw line, Brittany Williams. She does average 8 points a game, but she's only a 45% free throw shooter.
And this one rattles in and out. The personal foul, by the way, was on Pedro. For University, Ieysha Walker coming back into the lineup, the 5A junior. She'll replace Jordan Foyer, who's only a freshman. Once again, a reminder that Taco Bell, every free throw made, will donate $10 up to $500 to the IHSAA Centennial Scholarship Award. And she gets the second one.
Sitting right about at her average. One for two there.
Lead goes back to three, a 10-7. They've been ahead by as many as seven early on in the first quarter at University. Canterbury was spent half the first quarter without getting a point on the board. Give you the bio of Fort Wayne Canterbury. We have an opportunity to show you some info about the school. Minute and a half into the second quarter.
Canterbury running a little motion offense now. We mentioned earlier they were not running an offense early on, just kind of making one or two passes and resulting in a lot of turnovers. Now they're getting some fluid movement, causing University defense to move, and that time you see that's why they drew the foul. They were able to get University reaching.
That foul was on Walker. Ieysha getting her first personal foul. 6:20 to go now, period number two. That's the fourth team foul against University.
Got Walker on Gerardot, and Gerardo's got a definite size advantage, about 3.5 inches on Walker. She's catching the ball at the high post, but see her go down inside.
But when she does, blue shirts come from everywhere, and they force another turnover.
Yeah, they're going to make her give it up to her teammates. Now, Canterbury is not a one-player show. We've been mentioning a lot about Tabitha Gerardot as you see her driving down the lane. But you're right, help defense is right there. Three blue jerseys right around her. She's got to recognize that earlier and kick it before she gets into trouble.
A couple of minutes gone now, period number two. Class A championship, the Indiana High School Athletic Association girls state finals. We'll have four games for you today here on the Indiana Cable Network. Nice dish down the right side. A little five-footer is no good. And, well, the shooting is just not very good for either club right now. They came in shooting 45% did Canterbury and 42% for University.
We see that a lot because the backdrop is so different from a high school gym. There's nothingness back there. Girls aren't used to seeing that.
Body out of bounds, touch last by Canterbury. Substitution into the lineup for University, number 22, Allie Hughes, a 5'7 sophomore, playing now in her 18th game this year. Here's the field goal numbers. Boy, they're not very impressive, are they?
They're still, well, we've been talking about Canterbury poor shooting at 2 for 13, but University below 25% as well with 4 for 17.
Now, Canterbury's, both of Canterbury's field goals came in the first quarter, one from Holly and one from Gerardot. 3 minutes gone now here in the second quarter of this game. A pull-up 15-footer on the left side. Finally, that does fall for Katie Adlin. She has 4 points now.
Canterbury that time trying to trap out in the backcourt, trying to make something happen a little bit. They were able to get Adlin free.
And they broke the defense. They broke that pressure in pretty good shape, and Paige Wells gets in the scorebook for the first time.
Well, Wells' zone is a defensive stopper, but she had two big threes in their tourney trail, I'll tell you in about in a minute.
Long-range three was off the mark and chased down and saved by University. Back out to Walker. Another long-range shot is in the air. And it'll finally be out of bounds and belongs to University.
I mentioned Wells' two big threes in their upset over Oregon Davis. Right there you see getting out of the trap, and then Katie Adlam, nice pull-up jump shot. She's a very smooth player. And then Wells going strong to the basket. I thought she was going to miss the chippy, but she got it to drop out.
Walker threw it in. They may have a backcourt violation, but instead it's picked up by Canterbury. The driving layup, up and good this time. That's Aubrey Holle.
You wish that they would have had the backcourt if your coach Thornberry, they didn't want that transition basket.
Canterbury doing a nice job off the defensive boards, not giving University any second opportunities. Coast to coast, off the mark that time. And the rebound taken off by University, but thrown right into the hands of number 20, Paige Wells, for consecutive field goals for her. And five turnovers now for University. And all of a sudden, we've got our first lead change of the game with the Cavaliers now up by one, by a 13-12. Here's a look at that last opportunity for both clubs.
Basketball's a game of momentum. Aubrey Holle making that momentum happen by taking it strong to the basket. Paige Wells stepping in on that bad pass and taking it again to the basket. That's the key for Canterbury. The Cavaliers coming back and now taking their first lead.
4 minutes and 2 seconds to go, and all of a sudden a turnaround here. Becky Pedro, by the way, comes from a family that has a lot of experience in girls basketball. Her older sister, Amanda, is a senior at Fort Wayne Lures. She was a starter on the 2005-06 Class of 3A state champion and committed to play basketball at Indiana State University. Here's the bio on Canterbury. They are, of course, in Fort Wayne. Bob Shantz, the principal. Ken Harkin-Ryder, the AD. 300 kids. First trip to the state finals, likewise, for Fort Wayne Canterbury. Although they have won 3 state championships, all 3 in boys soccer, in 97, 98, and 2001. Once again, Jane, as I pointed out, it's one shot and gone for University right now. First lead change of the game. Canterbury has outscored him 6-0 over the last 45 seconds. Shot, not a very good one. Held ball, possession arrow, keeps the ball with Canterbury. A couple of substitutions now. Emily Strawbridge coming back into the lineup, along with number 33, Eric Hortz. Timeout has been taken, 3:37 to go, period number two. Well, it's been pointed out by the folks in the truck. Bob Montell is our director, and Matt John's our producer, that the flow to the game has not been real smooth. And Jane, I really thought they might settle down. We're halfway through the second quarter.
It has taken a little bit longer, I'm sure, than both coaches would like, because the timeouts that they've called have been after the other team goes on a run from turnovers from their team. We look at the shooting. It's just really miserable for both teams. Part of that is offensively, neither team has just settled down. They need to get a little more calm, run their offenses so they can get little looks at the basket. This quarter, 1-for-7 for University, 3-for-6 for Canterbury, but they've been turning the ball over.
And once again, as Jane pointed out, they're trying to get the ball into Gerardo's hands, and when they do, the defense comes from everywhere. You swear there's half a dozen defensive players out there. Once again, University, one and done. They're getting almost no offensive boards. 3:20 to go now in the second quarter.
We talked earlier about Canterbury's ability to rebound the basketball. Part of that is that player that just shot the ball, Tabitha Gerardot, averages a double-double. She averages nearly 11 rebounds a game.
Driving all the way to the hoop for the layup that again rims out, and the rebound comes off one more time to Fort Wayne Canterbury. They're getting decent looks, University is, but they're just not falling right now. Now they'll drop it inside. Good defensive play turned in by Board. She's the 5'11 sophomore who came in a couple of moments ago. She's playing it on her 6th game of the year.
Well, University's an interesting team. Never broke the top 10, as you see the pass go down to Kreiger, and a nice block out of bounds, but Fort Wayne Canterbury's going to retain possession.
Yeah, they were unranked at the start of the season. They finished up in a tie for 17th in the Indiana Coaches of Girls Sports Association. Hole and a whistle and a foul, and the indications are it'll be against, and it is number 13, Brittany Williams. That'll be her first.
Well, and University not used to playing close games. They're 16th in the state in scoring average margin. They beat their opponents on average by 16 and a half points a game this season, so they did not have very many close contests, something they're not used to.
Gerardot with 17 double-doubles on the season. This is the first free throw.
already has 7 rebounds, 5 on the defensive end, a couple of offensive, and we haven't even hit the halfway mark.
And the free throw shooting is not good for either club likewise, although percentage-wise, Canterbury shoots 69%, University right at 63%. 2.5 minutes to go now in the first half. 13-12, the first lead change of the game with Canterbury on top. They'll drop it inside and turn it over again. Unofficially, 6 turnovers now for University.
They've all been in the last, in this quarter.
And they'll lose it out of bounds. Last touch by Katie Adler. Well, the official stats show 8 turnovers now for University and 9 for Canterbury. 2:15 to go, first half. And they'll turn it over on the inbounds, and both teams a little confused now. Canterbury trailed 9-6 at the end of the first quarter, but they've taken the lead for the first time. Holding foul called against Canterbury.
Nice little play by University. Aaron Bort setting a ball screen there for Bria Sneed. Sneed comes off the screen, looks for the roll. Anytime you're covered up and you have the basketball coming off of a screen, look for your teammate who just set the screen, and that's who was open, Bort. See, she gets fouled, though.
Now we're right at 2 minutes to go here in the first half of this game. A wide open look straight on that's way short, and it'll be out of bounds to Canterbury. No points over the last 3-plus minutes for University. Only 3 in the quarter. They've had a field goal from Adlam and a free throw from Williams.
Again, trying to go into Gerardot. Defense all over her.
Oh, nice little give and go at the other end. And finally, they get something out of Bortz.
Both teams like to press, but neither team has really scored enough to get their presses going. But that time, at least, University able to get out and transition and get some easy points.
Gerardot tried to work her way in, commits the turnover as she traveled with it. Substitution now, Holle coming back into the game. Here's another look at that last play.
Yeah, you see Katie Adlam going down, and a nice bounce pass, lead pass to her teammate. Didn't even have to put it on the floor. That's the key. If you can give it to your teammate without having her make a dribble to make the play, she's usually going to score on the easy two.
1:23 to go in the first half of this game, and boy, just not much going in the quarter. 14-13 now with the Blazers back on top. That's the second lead change of the game. Right out front, nice looking shot that time by Bortz.
Well, a lot of times what happens, you get an easy layup, you start feeling good about yourself. Bortz, again, not one of their top scorers, but she does average nearly 9 points a game. She shoots 52% from the field.
They turned it over, University did. They had the rebound in the hands of Brittany Williams, and she lost it away to Gerardot, who gets her second field goal, 4th point, and cuts the lead to 1.
Second time, University's had trouble getting the outlet pass without a turnover, and it's resulted in 4 Cavalier points.
37 seconds to go. So University will get it with 25 seconds remaining here in the first half of this basketball game. We'll try to get a conversation with the leading coach at halftime, but at this particular point in time, it would be University as they have a 16-15 margin. We're down to the final 10 seconds. And a turnover again by Canterbury. That'll be 13 turnovers. Long-range shot at the buzzer is off the mark. So a somewhat discombobulated first half of play with neither club playing particularly well. University coming up with a 1-point lead, 16-15. They led in the first quarter by as many as 7 points. And then saw themselves lose the lead. And Canterbury took a 1-point lead. Had 2 lead changes in the game. And at halftime, the lead belongs to the Blazers of University. And again, the shooting, as we'll eventually get to the stats for you, is not very good. Let's go now to Jane.
Yeah, probably okay.
Is that all right?
You bailed on it?
Huh?
Well, we'll take a break and stay up, come back, and hopefully get a chance to chat with the coaches. Out of here at halftime, 16-15. We're back at Conseco Fieldhouse in downtown Indianapolis. Jerry Baker, Jane Schott, and the rest of our crew. There's your halftime score with the University Trailblazers leading by a 16-15 margin. Crowd beginning to fill in as we get set for the upcoming Class 2A game that is next up on the agenda. And that'll be Heritage Christian and Oak Hill. And that is the numbers 1 and 2 teams of the state. Heritage Christian, number 1. Oak Hill, the only unbeaten team in the final 8 teams to get here today. It's in the number 2 slot. That'll be the game that we'll have next. Then later on tonight, Chatard and Plymouth will battle in the first game of the second session tonight at 6. Followed by Jane, what I think is a very interesting game. Carmel and South Bend, Washington. We know about Skylar Diggins and all the wonderful things she has done up north. But Carmel is a club that is pretty effective. Likewise, they've won their way into the finals.
Well, it's going to be a great evening of basketball with both of those matchups. They're going to be terrific.
All right, we're going to take a break and we'll come back. We'll have halftime stats for you, some highlights likewise. There's your halftime score in the Class A championship game. A one-point game at halftime with University leading Fort Wayne Canterbury. Not a particularly well-played first half. A lot of turnovers, and both coaches will have to do some work in the locker room at halftime just to try to get their ladies settled out, if at all possible. Well, the two teams have come back out onto the court here at Conseco Fieldhouse. 16-15 score. These are two clubs that don't score a lot of points. But, Jane, I don't think any of us expected this kind of scoring at halftime. And the shooting, we'll get to the stats in a minute, shooting's just been horrendous.
It really has, and it's not necessarily due to great defense. They are both very good defensive teams, but they have just struggled offensively. No flow to the game. Hopefully these youngsters will settle down and we'll see a better offensive second half.
Let's show you some of the highlights in the first half of this game. Jane, we'll start off with University getting some putbacks. They have shot the ball. They've had some good-looking shots, Jane, but the problem is they don't get any second opportunity.
Well, Katie Adlam has been their main scorer, thankfully, for University. But she has 4 points, very balanced scoring, and they've all gotten into it. Now you see the Cavaliers, they got into it by taking the ball to the basket. Aubrey Holle, their senior, stepped up when it looked like they may not score in the first quarter. She got it done. Paige Wells helped out with that nice basket, and then she got the steal for another easy basket inside. That's got to be the key for the Cavaliers in the second half.
Here's some first half numbers, and this shooting is just awful. 7 of 29 is 24%. 6 of 26 is 23%. These are clubs that shoot right around 45%.
Yeah, and they both just really struggled. Maybe the backdrop, but I think they took, you mentioned it often, too quick of shots. One pass shot, and that was all they were getting. The other key is that the turnovers, 9 for University, 13 for Fort Wayne Canterbury. Too many for a half of basketball.
All right, we'll take a break and come back and get the second half tip-off for you. It's Fort Wayne Canterbury at University for the Class A championship. In the first half, as Jane mentioned, even scoring for University, 3 players with 4 points apiece, Adlam, Walker, and Bortz. Brittany Williams had 1 point but 4 rebounds for Canterbury, 6 points for Holly, and 4 each for Wells and Gerardot. Cassie Krieger had only 1 point, but a half a dozen rebounds. Gerardot, in addition to 4 points, had 8 rebounds in the first half. They need to get Gerardot into the game. University has the ball now, but when they get the ball back offensively, they've got to get Gerardot some better shots, I guess.
Yeah, I think she needs to settle down. She's rushing a little bit. You see Aubrey Holle getting a steal right there. The defense has definitely dominated this game.
Rebound comes off to University's Brittany Williams. As I mentioned, 4 rebounds in the first half. Pull-up shot right at the free throw line for Bria Sneed. Sneed had a 3-pointer back in the first quarter. That was her only scoring output to now.
And she's been pretty quiet, but that was, you know, she only took a couple of shots. I think she gets a lot of her, you know, points in transition off of steals.
And a foul will be called on Ieysha Walker. Looks like she had a lot of basketball, but she also had a piece of the arm. That'll be 2 on her.
Every time Fort Wayne Canterbury has taken the ball to the basket, University has had trouble containing that dribble penetration.
Almost a turnover and finally out of bounds and last touch by the officials conferring with each other. It'll stay in the hands of Canterbury.
A lot of contact. contact that time. Officials letting it go, so I just had to go by who it rolled off of.
Less than a minute into the second half, and that's Gerardot getting her third field goal. And keep in mind now, she's the gal they got to go to with 18-2 per game. Here's the three that's long, and the rebound taken down on the far side, right in front of the university bench by Fort Wayne Canterbury. Gerardot is only a sophomore, 5'11", 18-2, 10.8 rebounds, and they shut her down pretty good, although she did have 8 rebounds in the first half of this game. Down the lane, ball knocked free, another turnover on the part of Canterbury. Lots of turnovers in this game. That's 10 officially now on University and 14 now on Canterbury. Here's a three from outside that's good. That's Ieysha Walker. 7 points now for her, her 13th three of the year.
Yeah, remember, she was very active. She's one person that's shooting the ball very well. 3 for 5 from the field for Walker on the morning, and she's 1 for 2 from behind the arc.
They got an open look right out front just inside the free throw line, and they knock it down. That's Becky Pedro, and Pedro in the scorebook for the first time. Here's a young lady that averages just a touch under 5.5 points per game. And the same story holds true in the second half so far. University with just one shot and done. Another shot at the free throw line, and this time they put Gerardot out at the line, and she knocks one down from outside.
Easiest shot Gerardo's had this morning because she stepped out to the high post and pulled the defense away. She was able to knock down the 15-footer.
Believe it or not, Jane, the first tie of the game at 21. 5.5 to go now, third quarter. And a turnover again on the part of University. That'll be 10 on them. And back up court, knocked away, belongs to Fort Wayne Canterbury.
Third steal for Aubrey Holle. Her team doing a great job. They have 9 steals here so far. 3 for Gerardot to go along with that.
Ford's coming back into the lineup now for University with 5:20 to go in the third quarter. Inbounds play, got the ball right to Gerardot, right about the free throw line. She couldn't do anything with it. That's about 3 or 4 air balls we've seen, Jane. Do you think it's part of the backdrop situation?
Yeah, I do. I think, you know, kids are used to playing in the high school setting. You've got a wall right behind you. And from the three particularly, the depth perception is really effective.
Pedro getting her second bucket in this quarter as they tick inside 5 minutes. Here's the ball saved right at the timeline. Good job of the officials in keeping an eye on that. Well, they are all over University, and they'll get the personal foul. It looks like Paige Wells is going to pick up her first foul of the game, and that's where it's going to go.
Well, Pedro, usually a defensive stopper for them. She was one that had to guard the Minix girls, one of the Minix girls from Oregon Davis, but that time you see the nice inside-outside. They go to Gerardot first, then they kick it out for the wide-open Pedro to knock it down.
Long-range three off the mark by Walker, but they come up with the offensive rebound. 4.5 minutes to go now here in the third quarter. Walker will try it again. And in the process of trying to get her rebound, commits the foul. And on Ieysha, that is number 3. And that could be an issue because they need this young lady in the lineup.
She's been their steady offensive player. But having a player with 3 fouls in the third quarter, that's a long time to play. And expect them not to pick up their 4th.
Got a little dinger over the right eye there. They take her out, and Jordan Poyer comes into the ball game. There's been a lot of bumping and shoving out there, as you pointed out, Jane. The officials have pretty much let him play.
It's been consistent. That's what you want from an officiating crew. Just ask for consistency so the players know what they can do.
Almost a turnover, but instead a 3-point shot, but still good. Canterbury appears to be a little more aggressive defensively now than they were in the first half. Another turnover.
Krieger picked that steal up, and they're going to kick it out to Holle, but she misses the 3.
But there's Gerardot. She has 6 of the 10 points that Canterbury has scored in the quarter, and it's 25-21, an 8-0 run now for Canterbury, and they have their big lead of the game at 4. They led by only 1 point in the first half.
Well, the other thing about Walker going out is that she was guarding Gerardot, and the 8-0 run, part of that is Gerardot scoring. Walker's gone out with foul trouble, so now they're not as strong inside.
Nice defense by Bria Sneed. The ball goes back to University, and we'll go to a break with 3:27 to go in the third. Well, Jane, at the outset of the telecast, we focused on Tabitha Gerardot, the 5'11 sophomore for Fort Wayne Canterbury, and she did not have an impressive first half, 4 points, 8 rebounds, but she suddenly has come to life here in the second half. She had 6 of the 10 points on 3 field goals.
Yeah, she was only 2 for 8 in the first half, but now she's 5 for 11. She settled down and finally picked up the scoring for her team. I'm sure that must have been a talk of discussion in the halftime, because she's the one that has to share the scoring load for this Fort Wayne Canterbury team.
Yeah, they've got to have Gerardot if they intend to stay in the game, and right now they're not only in the game, they lead by 4, which is their biggest margin, and another turnover by University. A lot of turnovers. That's the 13th against them. Driving layup is off the mark. Again, only one shot and nothing else to follow that up with an offensive board. University comes back on the attack. They've got an advantage on the break, but just no shot available. Finally, they do get one just inside the free throw line from Katie Adlam.
Katie Adlam, that's her first scoring here of the second half. She had 4 points in the first half, and she is their scoring leader with 16 and a half a game.
That knocks it down to a 2-point lead, 25-23. Inside 3 minutes now here in the third quarter. This is the Class A IHSAA championship game at Conseco Fieldhouse in Indianapolis, coming to you live on the Indiana Cable Network. University hustling up court, got the left-handed layup and good by Bria Steed.
Well, we talked about her. She's the other leading scorer for University. She gets it off of their turnovers or in transition. That time, Canterbury just fell asleep and did not get back quickly enough off the turnover.
Second tie of the game at 25. University knocks the ball away in the form of Jordan Poyer, only a freshman at 5'6".
See Sneed getting up after she knocked that layup down. Right now, Fort Wayne Canterbury, they have got to limit their turnovers, because that's how University is scoring an awful lot of their baskets.
Yeah, turnovers are 16 for Canterbury and 13 right now for University. I'm sure that's a lot more than both coaches would anticipate. Here's the ball almost stolen away, but saved by Canterbury. They'll get it down, dropping it inside to Gerardot, and she had bodies all over her and gets the bucket anyway.
Well, you look at Gerardot, the first basket coming out of the second half was an offensive putback where she got an easy bucket and she seemed to relax. She got a step-out shot where no defense was on her, and she looks a lot more confident and comfortable here in the second half. As you see her catch, she splits two defenders and goes up strong. No chance for a block shot there. Both defenders staying straight up so they don't get the foul, but a good finish by Gerardot, and she gets the body foul, so she gets the opportunity for the old-fashioned three-point play.
Which she will get as the ball rattles in. The foul is on Brittany Williams, her second. And Gerardot in this quarter has 9 of the 13 points that Canterbury has put on the board. Less than 2 to go now, quarter number 3. Another air ball. That's at least 4 in this game, maybe more than that total by both clubs.
Well, that time, remember we talked about that same play in the first half, the ball screen and roll, and they hit Aaron Bortz for the roll. That time, Canterbury delayed off Snead and let her take the shot. It was a good defensive play for that reason.
You might have caught Canterbury's coach Scott Krieger as they get the ball inside to Gerardot again. She gets her own rebound momentarily, then has it ripped away by Bria Snead. Next time they come up court, if the cameras catch it, Scott Krieger is holding up signs. The last trip up, it was Duke that he held up. Now, he's still got the Duke sign in his hand. You can see him right there at the top of your screen. He's holding up and calling the offensive sets for Canterbury.
Nice take to the left side by Gerardot. Couldn't get it to go down. A right-handed player. She's probably a little more comfortable and stronger with her right, but she still took a nice drive to the basket, just couldn't get the basket to drop.
We're inside a minute now in the third quarter. Rebound into the hands of Jordan Poyer. Poyer with all kinds of pressure, almost turned it over in backcourt. 45 seconds to go. Will they go for one or just keep on firing? Looks like they're going to just keep on hustling to the hoop. They'll take the 3-point shot. Another air ball.
That one was short.
Yep.
And, you know, didn't get her feet up underneath her. You wonder if Jordan rushed it just a little bit. She's a young player, has not been in this situation before.
Gerardot has scored 11 of the last 15 Canterbury points. And we're down to the final seconds now of period number 3. They left. Pedro get inside unimpeded.
Well, she scored the other 6 points in this quarter, so it's been the Pedro Gerardot show here. Say that fast a few times in the third quarter. Great job by Fort Wayne Canterbury to push the lead out to five in the closing seconds.
Yeah, another air ball tossed up there on the personal foul and the ensuing attempt for pick up that loose ball by Adleman. That's number one on her. And that five-point lead is the biggest lead that Canterbury's had so far in this game. And right now, University head coach Bill Thornburg is not happy, really giving it to one of the officials on the far sideline. They'll shoot at the buzzer, and it's off the mark. Nice third quarter for the Cavaliers. At halftime, they were down 16-15. But through the third quarter, they have come back and taken a five-point lead. It's Canterbury 30 and University 25. Fourth quarter coming up. Well, it was the Pedro Gerardot show for Canterbury in the third quarter. Becky with 6 points and Tabitha with nine, giving her a total of 13 on the game. And Pedro, with her first 6 points of the ball game, they have scored the last 17 points, Jane.
Yeah, they've stepped up offensively. And it's not so much that University changed anything defensively. They finally just found the bottom of the basket and settled down. Those two players have been good scorers for them all through the season. They finally settled down and played better offensively. Look at the field goal shooting, still not very good overall. Rebounds, Canterbury 29-21. The turnovers, University has caught up. Remember, Canterbury had 13 turnovers in the first half. They did not have one in the third quarter.
So we start the fourth quarter for the Class A championship. And to be honest with you, University is going to have to step it up because Canterbury seems to have settled down a little bit.
They're running their offense right now. University still in the pressure man-to-man. That is one thing, Jerry, we have not mentioned. Yes, there's been poor shooting, but the defense has been, there aren't very many too many uncontested shots. The defense has been decent here this morning.
That's a very good point. Especially early on when Gerardot would get the ball inside, and as soon as she got it, they came from everywhere.
Yeah, they were double teaming her. She was able to solve that in the third quarter. She split that double team and found ways to get to the basket.
They had to take a timeout, they being University. They were trapped in the corner down there. That's one of the places you do not want to pick up your dribble. And you have a good look at Bill Thornburg. You talked about his athletic competition. He was in the IHSAA state track finals in 92 and 93 in the 3,200 meter run. Now he is under some extra pressure today. Let's keep a shot at him for just a second. If you check him, if you look at him and he's looking up into the stands, his wife, Carrie, is expecting their second child within the next 2 weeks.
Yeah, that's
Now, 2 weeks is a period where things
anytime.
Can happen.
You get to the any time. It could go any minute.
So he's under extra pressure. They've got a 2-year-old daughter, Isabella, but they're expecting number two within the next couple of weeks. You've got a couple of youngsters, so you know what he must be going through.
Yes, I'm sure that, you know, you've got to focus on your basketball, but when you put the basketball away at the end of the day, you got to go home and take care of the 2-year-old. And if you have an expecting wife, I'm sure that's even extra duties.
Yeah, good luck to him and the family in the future. 7:12 to go now, fourth quarter of play. After being down by 7 points, University, led by seven, Canterbury has come back strong. That's a nice tough shot by Brittany Williams.
Yeah, and a good feed by Sneed. Sneed penetrated down the middle of the lane and gave Williams a chance. Now you see University going into a half-court trap, a 1-2-2 half-court trap. Scott Kreiger takes a quick timeout. He doesn't want his team to turn the ball over.
Yep, good point, because they jumped into a different defense, and he quickly recognized that and called the timeout. Well, here's what's coming up next, Heritage Christian. And if you've not seen this club, you're in for a treat. Well, they got some terrific players. Oak Hill was ranked number two in the state behind Heritage Christian. And as I mentioned earlier, the only unbeaten team in the Final Eight. So that should be fun today. Glad to have you along on the Indiana Cable Network. Jerry Baker, Jane Schott, the rest of our crew will work hard all day long to get things brought your way.
You might mention Scott Kreiger. His father, Wayne, is the coach at Columbia City. Brought his team down here in 2000, the state 3A champ. So kind of a good basketball lineage. He's got his dad in the stands as well as his daughter on the floor.
He's a graduate of Columbia City Joint High School, Manchester College. Got his master's down at IU. They run a nice play on the inbounds, but get nothing out of it. Down by three, here comes University. Hard to the hoop. Kitty Adlam has been very aggressive, but she's not scored much. She has 6 points, a field goal in each quarter of this game, and she averages over 16 points per.
Well, she's shooting 3 for 13 right now. She's getting the shots she's used to taking, but they're not going down. We saw her hit a couple of nice jumpers in the first half, and you could see what kind of an offensive player she is, but she has struggled since then. Part of that due to the Canterbury defense not letting her get free for open looks.
Three, too hard, 6:18 to go now, period number four. University in the dark uniforms gets it across the line. A wide open look that catches rim and comes out long. Walker took it. Rebound came off to Holle.
Remember, Walker sat most of the third quarter with those three fouls, so she comes back in a little bit cold. Doesn't get the shot to go down.
Also wearing that bandage over the right eye from an incident somewhere in the first half of this game. Here's Gerardot inside, and she just had it stripped away. A nice defensive play that time by Adlin. Up court, and the ball is kicked away.
Nice, I was going to say, a nice feed by Aubrey Holle. Little wraparound bounce pass got Gerardot the basketball, but University recovered with the help defense right there. Walker and Adlam, as soon as Gerardot puts the ball down on the floor, you can't do that in the post. If you're going to get it stripped, it's exactly what happened. University comes up with a steal.
A shot from point-blank range wouldn't go that time for Bortz. And Canterbury hustles back and has one get away from him. Adlam comes off with the rebound and will get a foul.
Coach Scott Kreiger wants his team to slow down. They had a five-point lead, and I think in his opinion, maybe taking some ill-advised shots instead of looking for the best opportunity that they can get. When you get a lead in the fourth quarter, you don't want to start playing passively, but you want to be a little smarter with the basketball, take high-percentage shots, and force the other team to play defense on you.
The foul was on Pedro. That's number two on her. Now we're down to 5 minutes and 20 seconds to go, and a shot that was really created by her own ability to dribble the basketball. Bria Sneed, only a sophomore, now with 9 points.
A quiet 9 points. She's
yes.
Picked him up off of pushing the ball in transition and getting it. Now she's going to get a steal.
So after being down by five, University can take the lead. We've only had three lead changes in the game. Early on, it was all University as they led by seven. And suddenly they found themselves down, but they still led at halftime, 16-15. Trailed at the end of the third quarter, 30-25, and they turned the ball over again. Well, will they or will they not? Nope, they managed to get it back, and very quickly, Bill Thornburg jumps in to call a timeout. And we'll take a break with 4 minutes and 38 seconds to go in the fourth quarter. The Class A title still very much up in the air. It's a 30-29 ball game. Jana, just taking a look at here, the fewest combined total points scored by Class A championship teams, both teams. The fewest is 82. That happened in 2004 when Tri-Central beat Washington Catholic 46-36. We're on mark to destroy that record right now.
I'm not sure either team is going to put up the needed points to get up over that combined total. We are 59 right now, and we've got to get to 82 in 438. Unless something miraculous happens and both these teams stop playing defense, maybe that's about the only way we're going to get those point totals.
Well, the fewest points scored by a Class A championship team was 45, North Vermilion, back in 2002. They've got a ways to go to get to 45, 15 points with the final four and a half. And the way the shooting has been, here's a traveling violation. University now with its 14th turnover. Field goals this quarter, University 2 of 5, and Canterbury 0 for 4. Their last field goal was with just under 15 seconds to go in the third quarter.
Remember, we talked about that shot selection. Coach Kreiger upset, getting his team settled down, and University has gone now to their full court trap, the 2-2-1 trap, full court press defense. Canterbury's able to break it and get into their offense.
Now let's see, Jane, do they run a more dignified offense, if you will, a more prescribed,
passing motion offense. You see them, they're probably gonna just look for either, not that, a turnover, but they were probably gonna look for a point, a shot in the paint, something, a good look, high percentage shot, because if you've got a lead, you're the ones that have basket. You're able to work the basketball. You don't have to catch up. Now, the lead's only one, though. Now,
I know.
Very few coaches will pull it out with this much time to go with only a one-point lead.
Jane, I was just thinking, if either of these clubs got, let's say, a 3 or 4 point lead, they might go into some kind of a freeze.
Yeah, they, you know,
both teams are shooting very well.
Right. Both teams are in a man-to-man, so you can't stand there and hold the basketball, but you definitely can work it.
And they turn it over instead. Well, turnovers have just been so critical, not just the number, but the time that they have occurred.
Yeah, that time University needed to get a look at the basket because they're down one nearing the three-minute mark.
A whistle, and I think Canterbury wants a timeout, and indeed they do. It's a full timeout taken by Fort Wayne Canterbury as they find themselves up by one, Jane, with 3:20 to go. Now, what in the world do you think they're talking about over there? Are we talking about what you and I were just talking about?
I think so, because I think Coach Scott Kreiger, you know, obviously I'm not in his head, but he's watching his team try to run his offense and take care of the basketball and take some time off the clock, I guess, but then he wasn't pleased with what he was seeing. So he calls that timeout because he knows this is a very critical possession. He got with his coaching staff, made the decision on what he's going to do. We'll have to see when they come out. Look for University to do something trapping. They are known for their half-court trap, full-court trap, so they're probably going to come out and try to force another turnover. They got the turnover last time. Really, it was unforced, but they weren't able to convert on the other end.
Well, next week, the Indiana Cable Network will be down at Southport Fieldhouse celebrating its 50th year. A great facility. And we're going to have the winner at Warren Central Sectional versus the winner at Brownsburg. And then in game two, you'll see Carmel and Perry Meridian. We'll have the championship game that night. Now, the Carmel game, the Carmel Sectional Championship, Jane, is in a bit of a movement stage. They're going to have to play Monday night.
Yeah, that's something that often happens, because they want both teams to be able to support each other and the people in the community to support
Absolutely.
Both teams.
And they do great attendance in the Carmel Gymnasium up there where they're having the sectional. Inside, Gerardot misses the shot, got her own rebound, and there's three blue shirts all over her and a lane violation called against her. That's the last call I would have expected.
Yeah, I didn't know that there were 3 seconds after the shot had gone up, I got to admit. Every inbound play underneath the basket has been for Gerardot. So you know it's going to her on the block. So does University. Look at all those blue jerseys around her, and she cannot get the ball out. There may have been 3 seconds. I'm going to retract my evaluation of the officials
there.
Yeah,
she was right in there a long time, and the official was right on top of it. Here's another steal, a near steal. Saved, though, on the near sideline by Forts. Then they get it inside. Cannot get the layup by Brittany Williams. And we'll get a whistle and a foul against University.
University has tried to hold up the rebounder. The two main rebounders for Fort Wayne Canterbury have been Tabitha Gerardot and Cassie Kreiger. You see Kreiger rip it down right there. Three jerseys around her. A lot of contact on the arms. She's pivoting exactly what you want him to do and tries to get the outlet, but never does. Draws the foul instead.
Sneed picks up that personal foul with 2 minutes and 42 seconds to play in the game. Crowd wanted a turnover. And we'll get it down inside. A whistle and a held ball. Possession arrow will give the ball to University. Well, that'll go down as a turnover. 21 now on Canterbury. Canterbury has not scored in over 5 minutes. They do not have a point in this quarter with just 2.5 minutes to go.
Their defense has done the job. Remember, they had that 5-point lead, but they've been able to hold off University, who has not done a great job scoring as well.
Another held, that's right, another held ball this time to Canterbury. Yep, University only has 4 points in the quarter. Remember now, going into the fourth quarter, it was 30-25 in favor of Canterbury. So they've added 4 points to University to make it a 1-point game at 30-29.
Here comes that full court press. Canterbury able to break it and get a layup, but miss it.
And a foul on the ensuing rebound on Bria Sneed, number two on her. Well, the shooting just continues to be very, very bad. Well, for every free throw made tonight, Taco Bell's going to donate $10 up to $500 to the IHSAA Centennial Scholarship Award. Up there trying to add some is Paige Wells of Canterbury.
Wells, a 65% free throw shooter, very upset with herself. couple things. One, she turned the ball over. Remember that the turnover that she had. She was upset. Coach Kreiger said, get back and play defense. That was a good move to try to get her head back in the game. He needs her. Then she missed the layup, so she's really struggling right now. Nice to see her step up and hit a free throw, kind of settle it down.
5 points for her now. The first point of the quarter for Fort Wayne Canterbury. And we have a two-point ball game again. The Cavaliers lead by two now with 31-29. University trying to tie or go ahead as we approach the two-minute mark of the fourth period. Driving left side, Adler. Long-range three, Snead. No good. Now knocked out of bounds. Last touch by University. So Canterbury will get it.
Good hustle play by Brittany Williams. Just couldn't track it down. Adlam's been quiet. They haven't got the ball into her hands very often. Jerry, they've been going to the opposite side. This time, Snead brings it to her side, and they actually got a good look at the basket, but couldn't get it to go down.
Scott Kreiger taking a 30-second timeout, and I'll guarantee you, this is to set up your offense, what you're going to do here in the final 157. Canterbury has won 8 sectionals. They've won 2 regionals. Their last regional win was back in 2004, their first semi-state win this year. It's the ball club that went 22-3 last year and lost to Oregon Davis in the regional. They were number 2 in the final ranking last year. This year, they were number 9 in the coaches, the ICGSA poll. The IBCAA poll, which ranks them regardless of class, they were unranked there. They started the season 5th, and they have won 13 consecutive games since their loss on the 5th of January to a really good Karma club, 65-48.
Well, and they've, you know, they've had a great tradition there. Coach Krieger's done a great job. You know, you coach Megan King, a Canterbury class of 2007 senior, and she was the 3rd leading scorer in the state of Indiana, 5th among all boys and girls with 2,652. So great basketball is no stranger to Fort Wayne Canterbury.
You betcha. A minute 45 now. Let's see what Canterbury wants to do. They've got a 2-point lead. They get it inside, and they miss the shot, and out in a hurry comes Adler. We mentioned she has not been much of a factor scoring-wise. Walker has been. This one rims out. Rebound is on the floor. They chase it down. A hell ball. Possession arrow to Canterbury.
Great box out by Fort Wayne Canterbury again. We've talked about the fact there haven't been a lot of second opportunities for University. Only 6 the entire game. On the flip side, Canterbury's got 11 offensive rebounding. They're out-rebounding the... Cavaliers are out-rebounding the Trailblazers 37-26 in this game.
Now, the confusion is that the possession arrow was pointing the wrong direction. Yeah. Fort Wayne has missed its last 8 field goal attempts, and they're allowing University to stay in this ballgame with a minute 31. We pointed out if anybody could get a 3 or 4 point lead, they might put it in the deep freeze. They'll go in the middle. Now the hell ball will send it the other way.
Remember, Coach Kreiger called the timeout to be able to get through this press. You see, it's just a man-to-man press. They're switching on screens to try to get a help ball or a steal. And right now, the defense is swarming, and they get the steal.
And they got the ball inside. The missed shot from point-blank range by Williams. And it's out of bounds to Canterbury. Well, they've had some good looks.
A lot of good hustle plays on both teams. They're really going after it hard. It's 31-29, 1:17 left to play, so both teams have an opportunity.
Canterbury shooting 26.5%. University shooting 24.5%. It's just killed them, the shooting here this morning. 1 minute to go in this game. Now they're going to put the pressure on.
University looking to trap, and right now, Canterbury just trying to hang on to the basketball and not turn it over.
Adlam with number 2.
You see the trap coming up top. That left Kreiger wide open. She squares up, and Adlam coming quickly to make the foul. That's going to put Kreiger at the line.
Cassie, 1 out of 2 from the stripe. These are big. 5'7" sophomore averages 10.5 per game, but she has come up with only 5 so far tonight, or this afternoon. Well, I guess it's a couple of minutes. It's still morning. You get in here and you forget what time of the day it is.
You don't know where the sun is.
The rebound by Gerardot, and she put it up and will go to the line. Oh, how big was that?
Well, she came from the right side of the basket. Jerry, the miss was just perfect for her to get the rebound. It's rare that you get an offensive rebound on a free throw because, you know, the defender's already on the inside, but she came along the outside on the right side and was able to slide in around and get the offensive putback and draws the foul.
Well, after Gerardot had 9 points in the third quarter, that was her first bucket in the fourth quarter, and with 50 seconds to go, it's back to a five-point game, and that equals the biggest lead that Canterbury has had so far in the game. Canterbury comes off with a defensive rebound. They're going to have to commit the foul if they can catch somebody with the basketball. Good movement by Canterbury to keep it alive and just eat up seconds on that clock, and here is that foul.
Well, and you can tell, I'm not sure if Fort Wayne Canterbury players felt this, but Aubrey Holle, she wanted the ball in her hand. She's standing out there by herself, and when she got it, she didn't attempt to pass it. She waited for someone to come and foul her. She is their best free throw shooter on the team.
Kendra will be at the line, but before she can go there, she'll have to face a timeout taken by University. The Trailblazers of University High School, their first ever appearance in any kind of a championship. They're 20 wins and 6 losses. Canterbury is 20-5. And it's been one of those games where if either club, Jane, had shot anything at all, they'd be ahead by 10.
Well, I thought if somebody did get ahead, Jerry, I was going to have to say, you know, that the other team playing so poorly, you got to feel fortunate to be within. Well, both of them playing so poorly, just together, if any of them had, you know, even found a streak.
Yeah.
You know, 2 or 3 minute streak where you hit the range, it probably would have been over. Both teams did not have that, but part of it was defensively, they kept battling back. Fort Wayne Canterbury got down early, they battled back, and then it made it at the halftime a very close score, and then Fort Wayne Canterbury pushed it out in the beginning of the second half, and here comes University again. So it's been a very hard fought ball game, just not necessarily a very, you know, pretty ball game.
Well, we'll have the 2A game coming up next with Oak Hill and Heritage Christian. So stand by for that here on the Indiana Cable Network. Fort Wayne with 7 minutes and 22 seconds between field goals. And yet they're still in front.
Aubrey Holle, an 80% free throw shooter, has shot. Wow, you're 84%, misses the first one.
Well, they got to hurry now, goes University. Here's a three. Oh, my goodness, how big was that by Ieysha Walker. That's her second three of the game, her first point contribution in the fourth quarter. She's in double figures, and we've got 23.6 to play. And it's a two-point ball game.
It's not over yet. It never is over yet. She misses the free throw. Quick outlet transition. Ieysha Walker has been money from behind the arc. That's her second triple on the game. She 2 for 6 on the night in the morning. And for this game, that's hot shooting, unfortunately.
That really is hot shooting. She had a wide open look, and she was out behind both of those three-point areas. Turnovers, University with none. Timeouts, I should say, University with none, and Fort Wayne with two. So University cannot stop the clock.
Yep, Coach Bill Thornrigg is obviously setting up their what they want to do. Defensively, they're going to come along, try to make something happen probably here in the backcourt. If they don't get a steal, then you would expect them to foul. But you would expect that they're going to try to, with their defense that they have, they're going to try to steal the ball before they foul somebody, you would expect. Right now, Fort Wayne Canterbury's got to get the ball in. They've got timeout, so that's in their favor. They've got to get the ball in and get it past half court without turning it over.
Well, with the number of turnovers we've seen, Jane, nothing would surprise me because a turnover would be humongous right now.
Yeah, and this game is far from being over, for sure.
23.6 to play, fourth quarter, Class A championship, 34-32 in favor of the team with the basketball, and they make a breakout with Gerardot, but she wisely just turns around and comes back out. Now they commit the foul.
Well, that was a screen, and what we talked about it earlier, Gerardot set the screen for the guard to go down and catch the basketball, and she rolled open, and she was the person that was open. A great job by the inbounder to get her the basketball, not turn it over. Now you've got your money player. Tabitha Gerardot's got 15 points, but she's only had 1 for 4 free throw on the morning.
And this one is short, so she's missed two in a row, critical.
By the way, she does have her double-double. We talked about the fact that she averages a double-double. She's got 17 boards to go along with those 15 points. A terrific game for the sophomore.
Well, this is big, but it still makes it a one-possession game if she makes the free throw. And she does. 16 points now for Tabitha. 16 points, 17 rebounds. And another timeout that's taken by Canterbury, of course. Canterbury shooting 28% now on 14 of 55. University 14 of 55, I should say. At 33%. So the shooting has improved a little bit. University ranked 43rd in the entire state in defense, so they're going to need some to keep themselves alive. Here's the next game. Combined total of 52-1 for the next two teams. Heritage Christian has a couple of outstanding players. Likewise, Oak Hill. Christian, number one in the state in two-way. Oak Hill, number two in the state. And that will follow our game here. Of course, following the game, we'll have the Mental Attitude Award, the presentation of the runner-up medallions and the championship medallions, as well as the runner-up and championship trophies. We'll cover it all for you here on the Indiana Cable Network. There's the reset for you. University, we pointed out, with no timeouts left. Canterbury's got one if they need it. What do we do here, Jane? Does University just hustle up court and try to get the bucket as fast as they can, I assume?
Yeah, they don't have any timeouts, so they're going to probably try to get a quick score and look for them to just go for the two.
Down to 13 seconds and a steal, and how big was that? And a very quick foul coming in from behind, Katie Adlin. I said the turnovers might be big in the last 30 seconds. None bigger than that one.
Well, you could tell they were just going to try to go to the basket. Bria Sneed so good at getting past defenders, but she loses her balance. And they were able to pick it up, but in picking it up and in the panic, made an errant pass. Cassie Kreiger stepped in the passing lane. Great job by the sophomore. Dribbles it out of trouble, and she knocks down the free throw.
Kreiger averages 10.5 points a game, and she has not had a field goal tonight. She has 3 points to her total. She's 3 out of 4 from the stripe. And it is a 4-point game, so basically lights out. Here comes the three way off the mark, another air ball, and the clock will stop at 1.2. And that's how far Fort Wayne Canterbury is from picking up their first ever girls basketball championship, the fourth championship overall for the school. And that's it. There's your final score, 36-32.
As the players celebrate in the middle, Coach Scott Kreiger looks over to the fans, puts his fist up in the air with a big smile on his face. Always bittersweet. You see one team that's happy and one team that's sad, but you look at Coach Bill Thornburg talking to his players and all that, looking up in the stands and all the people that supported University. What a great accomplishment in such a short time for him to bring his team to this state championship.
And it's tough to be the defeated team, and that's one of the things they talk about at the Monday meeting when they have all the coaches and school representatives coming in, is not only how to win properly, but how to lose properly. And they have done a marvelous job. This University program, I can't say enough about them. Jane, they really came out of nowhere. I mean, you can't put a program together that's that good in that short of time.
You mentioned Bill Thornburg saying that he knew that he was going to, you know, we were going to be playing on March 1st. He may be the only person in the state of Indiana that thought his club could do that, but a lot of times that's what it takes, a leader or a visionary to say this is what we're going to do, and his team followed him, and they had a terrific season.
Well, you take a look at how they had to get here, University. They had to knock off the number 10 team of the state, White River Valley, in the championship game of the Southwestern Shelbyville Regional. They did that in good fashion, winning by 19. And then in the Jeffersonville semi-state, they knocked off the number 4 team of the state, Northeast Du Bois, by 16 points. In fact, their average winning margin in the tournament was almost 29 points a game. So this was a very good University team. They only lost to Brebeuf Jesuit, Indianapolis Chautauqua, which is a 3A school, as was Brebeuf, by the way. And then they lost to 3A Hamilton Heights. So they've had to play some tough games against 3A schools this year. They lost to a couple of Kentucky teams and one team out of Tennessee. So they traveled this year. Ah, the thrill of victory. Deb Stevens is going to be the lady on the platform, one of the members of the IHSAA board. Canterbury with five losses this year to Southwood, a 2A school. Fort Wayne South, a 4A school. Fort Wayne Elmhurst and Indianapolis Chautauqua, 3A schools. And they lost at Carmel, a very good Carmel team that will play for the 4A title tonight. They lost to them 65-48. We're getting ready for the presentation now of the Mental Attitude Award. That in itself is a terrific honor. The members of the IHSAA Executive Committee will make that presentation to the Patricia L. Roy Mental Attitude Award. Let's go up to Deb Stevens now of Caston High School.
Scholarships have been presented by Indiana Farm Bureau Insurance to deserving high school students in our state. On behalf of the IHSA, please join us in saying thank you to Indiana Farm Bureau Insurance for its generous support of our student athletes. After we announce the name of the recipient, we invite her parents to join her on the arena floor. The recipient of this award, while a student in grade 12, was nominated by the principal and coach, excelled in mental attitude, athletic ability, scholarship, and leadership during the 4 years of high school, participated as a state finalist in this sport, and was selected by members of the IHSA Executive Committee. The winner of the 2008 Patricia L. Roy Mental Attitude Award for Class A Girls Basketball is Aubrey Ann Holle.
Aubrey Holle of Fort Wayne Canterbury picks up the Patricia L. Roy Mental Attitude Award. Four-year starter on the varsity team, served as team captain the last 3 years, the school's record holder in assists and steals, student council representative serving as vice president. She's a member of the Key Club. Hasn't decided on her college choice yet, but she wants to study chemistry and or biology on the pre-med route and hopes to continue playing basketball, maybe soccer as well. Her parents are Doug and Camille Holle of Fort Wayne. Our congratulations to Aubrey Holle, the Mental Attitude Award winner. Well, your final score again is Canterbury 36, University 32. We'll take a break and come back with more of the ceremonies here at Conseco.
Okay. I'm with Aubrey Holle, the Mental Attitude Award winner. Aubrey, congratulations. Did you ever think coming into the day that this is how you were going to end, a state championship and the Mental Attitude Award winner?
I knew this was going to be a great day coming in. I've been, you know, dreaming about this since I was a little girl. And I knew once we got here, our team, we were going to do everything we could to get it done, and we did. We came out hard. You know, it wasn't pretty in any way, but we got the win, and that's what good basketball teams do. And, I mean, I'm ecstatic. I was brought to tears. I'm so happy.
Well, we'll talk about your team in a minute, but I want to talk about you. Your senior leadership was critical. You guys had a bad start. When you finally hit a shot, everybody seemed to relax.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of jitters coming out here. This is the epitome of Indiana basketball right here, and we were all a little nervous, but I knew it was going to come out and it was going to be like that, and I just was like, all right, I'm going to take my shots and I'm going to make one, and then the team's going to start going. We had a good run. That's what we've been doing all year, making runs. That's what basketball is.
Well, you're more than a basketball player, a terrific person off the floor, a great sportsman on the floor, as well as a great student. Putting it all together, how have you done it your high school career?
That's just the way I was brought up. My parents are great. I surround myself with good people at school, my friends, my family, my coaches, my teammates especially. They make it so easy. The school, the environment, that's what you're brought up to do. And, I mean, that's just it. I've excelled in that, and I am thankful for everyone that's helped me along the way.
Well, congratulations on a terrific honor and a great day. Back to you, Jerry.
All right, Jane, thank you. Holle finished up with 6 points and 4 rebounds, a couple of assists and 3 steals in this game. Back with more in just a moment here on the Indiana Cable Network. Well, if somehow you just dialed by, it's 36-32 the championship score. Class A, Fort Wayne Canterbury the winner. Let's go back again to Jane Shaw. Jane?
Well, I'm standing next to the winning coach, Coach Scott Kreiger. At the beginning of the season, Coach, did you think that your team could make it to this day on March 1st?
Well, honestly, no. We were a young group, and you know, having graduated two really, really strong seniors, you just don't. I mean, you set your goals high, but realistically, it's so hard to get here. So honestly, I just, you know, that was not one of our immediate goals. Now, as the season wore on, it became a goal. So, you know, at Christmas time and thereafter, we felt like we could, but it took a while to get us going.
Well, congratulations. We talked a little bit. It wasn't pretty, but you got the job done. Your team overcame some really terrible shooting, and your defense was what held you in the game all the way through.
Well, and it's been our defense all throughout the tournament series. You know, some games you shoot well, some games you don't. Certainly today we didn't. We didn't in practice yesterday. I was concerned about that. But we said defense wins championships. We had a good defensive game plan. The kids went out and made it happen. So,
well, we're going to let Coach go get his medal. Congratulations on a great tournament game and a state championship. Coach Scott Kreiger, back to you, Jerry.
Jane, that's what is happening right now. They're handing out the blue medallions to the championship team for Wayne Canterbury. Back in a minute. Well, there's the presentation of the championship trophy to a group of happy young ladies in Why Not. Fort Wayne Canterbury Cavaliers finish up the year at 21-5. So we mentioned they were ranked ninth in the state in the Indiana Coaches of Girls Sports Association poll. And they're a group of happy young ladies. Rather happy coach likewise, Jane, who's joined us back here at the table at courtside. And there's nothing like winning a title like that.
And I'm really pleased for him and his team. As you see Tabitha Gerardot holding on to the basketball, she's a great player. I don't think she's going to let that go.
We'll see if later
tonight she might still have that in her hands.
Well, the final score again is 36-32. Time for the most valuable player of the game, brought to you by TripToCollege.org. Be your child's most valuable parent. And visit TripToCollege.org today for your family's college planning at every age. Well, there are so many players you could have picked out, but I guess you got to go with Gerardot. She finally came to life in that third quarter and turned the game around.
Half of her points in the third quarter. She ends up with a double-double and tied the total rebounds for a player, 17. Skylar Diggins had 17 last year, and she picks up 17 here this morning to go right along with it. Two great players.
I thought it was interesting that Aubrey Holle said it wasn't very pretty. This was not a thing of beauty today.
And, you know, Coach Kreiger said that as well. They know they didn't play their best offensive game, but their defense held them through all the way through the season as well as today. So they're the ones that come away with the championship.
All right, we'll take a break and come back with more of the festivities between games. The net cutting is coming up next. Final score, 36-32. Jerry Baker along with Jane Schott back now with Conseco Fieldhouse, and now the celebration continues with the cutting down of the nets. Let's take a look first, though, at the Comcast high-speed play of the game. Comcast, TV, internet, voice, it's all about options. Jane, you pointed this out as we're going to show you the play of the game here. This is coming off a missed free throw. This was a big rebound.
It really was. The miss by Kreiger, and Gerardot goes around the outside, an odd place to try to go get it. The miss was perfect right into her hand. She puts it up, gets the two. Chance for the three-point play because she was fouled. She missed that, but it ended up not making a difference.
Yeah, I wanted to make a mention, Jane, what we were just talking about here. There, one of the young players out there, Molly Kula, who did not get in the game today, but is that her on the, I can't tell if,
it
yeah,
is.
That's her on the ladder. She plays with diabetes. She has diabetes and wears an insulin pump all the time except while playing. Even though she's a senior at 5'5", even though she didn't get in, this has got to be just a great moment for her.
Only two seniors on that team, and we've already highlighted one of them with the Mental Attitude Award, Aubrey Holle, and now Molly Kula gets to go up and cut down the net. So what a great thing.
Right. I've got to say, the point made to speed things up, they've asked for one player to go up and cut it down. I'm sure the team member said, Molly, yeah, you're our choice.
Most definitely. She's already got her insulin pump back on, Jerry. You mentioned she doesn't wear it when she plays, but she's got it back on. A big smile on her face, holding up the net to the fans and her teammates.
Well, we'll take another break. There's that championship trophy. It belongs in the showcase at Fort Wayne Canterbury High School. Our congrats to you. Well, Jay, we thought there might be a couple of records set. The fewest points scored by a Class A championship team was 45 coming into the day, 36 for Fort Wayne Canterbury. The combined of the two teams was 82, and they total up today 68. That just gives you an indication what kind of a game it was. Let's move on now and take a look at the final stats, and I guarantee you the field goal shooting will just scare the daylights out of you. 25% for University, 28% for Canterbury.
Both teams really struggle to find the bottom of the basket. Behind the arc, not any better. 3 for 11 for University, and no three-pointers for Fort Wayne Canterbury, but the defense prevailed. Turnovers. Canterbury only at 23, and University at 17.
That rebound number is really one-sided, 49 to 35. It seemed like that was offset with the turnovers because 49 rebounds, 23 turnovers, and then 35 rebounds and 17 turnovers.
Part of that is they had more shooting opportunities. If you don't turn the ball over, you shoot it more, and that results in more offensive rebounding opportunities. That's what it was for Canterbury. They were able to get around and pick up 16 offensive rebounds on the day.
Well, it was not a thing of beauty, as was pointed out when Jane was interviewing Aubrey Holle. But this is one of those things, you take it any way you can get it. And the C block is very happy, the Fort Wayne Canterbury crew that came down for the north part of the state. And our congratulations to them, and congrats to the university. A terrific experience for them, and a great honor just to make it to the finals, considering how young this school is. Another break coming up as they put up new nets to get set for the 2A championship game. We'll take a break likewise. Well, the outstanding crew here at Conseco Fieldhouse in the process of putting up new basketball nets after Fort Wayne Canterbury has cut them down as to go in the trophy case. Let's take a look at the leading scorers for these two teams. You're not going to see an awful lot of scoring for University. Walker with 10. She had a big three-pointer there toward the end of the game. Ieysha did. In fact, she had 2 3-pointers. Sneed was second with 9. Gerardot was 16, and she had 9 of those. Jane in that third quarter that turned the whole ball game around. You had 17 rebounds. She had a terrific game.
She really did. 7 for 18 from the field. She didn't shoot well from the free throw line, but everywhere else, an outstanding game for Tabitha Gerardot.
Both clubs had only 5 players scoring in the game, 6 each, as you saw there for Holle and Kreiger. They didn't get much bench scoring out of this game today. In fact, Aaron Bortz had 4 for University. One of the starters, Amy Strawbridge, 5'10 sophomore, did not score in the game. But again, a terrific game for Tabitha Gerardot, a 5'11 sophomore. But what we're going to do is take a break, and we're going to be right back with the Heritage Christian Oak Hill game for the 2A championship. Final score again, Fort Wayne Canterbury 36, University 32 for the Class A championship on the Indiana Cable Network.